Welcome to Peninsula Seniors Out and About. Today we're here with racing legend Parnelli Jones. How did you get into racing, Parnelli?
Well, actually, I started out, in riding horses and stuff like that, and racing these guys on the quarter horses, and I became a pretty good jockey, so to speak. And in doing so, guys would let me ride their horses and give me a few bucks and things, and that maybe it propelled me to be somewhat competitive. But in doing so, later when I turned 16, I sold my horse and bought a hot rod, and it kind of started from there, because then I used to have to work in the garage after school to keep my hot rod running. And my cousin took his wife's old jalopy and decided to make a jalopy out of it, tore it all up, and because I was working in the garage, he thought I ought to help him, and I did so. And he used to let me warm it up. And
did that hook you on racing?
Well, yeah, because I was really hooked on just driving cars, so to speak. And when you turn 16, obviously, you know, that's all you think about is girls and cars. And so I did. And he ran the car for a couple of years and didn't do very well in it. And I got a chance to buy it from him, a buddy of mine. He blew the engine up and we bought it, and we were going to take turns driving it. Of course, I was only 17 years old at the time, so made up a phony identification for me, because the kids in school would have known who I was if I didn't have a phony identification. But anyway, from there, I didn't do very well either, but I got the bite. You know, I mean, I took the bit and had a lot of fun with it, but. My buddy got drafted into service and about that time, so for a couple of years there, we didn't do anything. And when he got out of the service, we now were a little better financially positioned to build another car, and we did. And I had just enough experience from the first time that I thought I ought to win every race, you know. And they were calling me the Wild Man because I was wrecking my car in the first corner. And I had all this desire, no talent, frankly. And somebody, after wrecking my car, finally blew the engine up, and I didn't have enough money to fix it. And a guy just seen something he liked about me. And he says, I'll build an engine for your car if you'll just listen to me. Sure, anything. So I did, and with that, he built an engine. His engine run better, and all he told me was slow down, quit trying to win the race in the first corner. And obviously I was fortunate then to start winning some races.
How'd you get the name Parnelli?
Well, when I first started having to have a phony identification, my first name is Rufus and my middle name is Parnell. And my buddy used to kid me all the when we were going to school, there was a little gal and had freckles and stuff like that, and her name was Nellie. And so he used to kid me about that, and so he called me Parnelli all the time. And so when I had to have this phony identification, he made it up and he put Parnelli on it instead of my first name, Rufus, because the kids in school, if I went by Rufus, they didn't know that I wasn't 21 years old to drive.
Parnelli, you've always been interested in competition, haven't you?
I've always been a very competitive individual. I think you're born with that somewhat. I mean, but I'm not a daredevil. You know, I always wanted to win at whatever I did. And, that competitive spirit probably took me a long ways, probably more than anything else. But, we call it will to win. You know, I think in racing, that's what you have to have. And a lot of great, talented race drivers that just may be lacking a little bit of will to win. And I think the will to win carries you a lot further down the road.
You say you're not a daredevil, but Pike's Peak, Parnelli, that's really on the edge.
No question about it. Pike's Peak's the most dangerous race course I've ever ridden. And the first half of the course is in the trees and stuff like that. So, and then when you leave the tree line, the last half of the race is, straight off and everything else. But I want to assure you, I run as fast as I could through the trees, And when I got to the place where there was no tree, no straight off and that sort of thing, I made sure I got to the top. If I won, fine and dandy. But if I didn't, I'd take that at two. But, you know, I always said it takes no talent to run down and hit the wall. It takes a lot of talent to go down there and maximize your speed as much as you can and stay on course. And I've taken that attitude.
Can you tell us a little bit more about the jalopies and where you went from there?
Well, actually, the jalopies were a great part of my career because, you know, we used to run three times a week with them cars, and sometimes we'd have as many as 200 cars show up to qualify. And not every week, don't get me wrong, but, you know, you had to give it 110%. You actually had to give it 120%. I mean, you had to maximize everything you could. And I've seen the main event with the cars just finished almost like they started. But it kind of hurt me when I went into other types of racing because I was so held on trying to maximize everything I could do. To when I went into different types of racing, I didn't have that same competition. So it didn't hurt me because I didn't treat my equipment well and didn't finish a lot of races that I should have. And so on and so forth. But anyway, at one time I went to out to Ascot, and it was a NASCAR modified race. And I was sitting up in the grandstands, and one of the guys that was driving one of the jalopies knew me, and he came up there and he saw me, and he said, "You want to drive this car that I'm got down there that's modified?" I said, "Sure." And he said, "Well, let me go down and introduce you to the car owner." So he took me down, and I introduced him to the guy, and anyway, I went out and won the main event. So I owned that ride. So that was like a step forward. And then I started, I actually was sitting at home and I'd driven a late model stock car. I'd got a sponsor and a guy let me drive one race for this guy. And so I get a little taste of running late model stock cars and fell. Milicich, my partner, which later became my partner, was the Ford dealer in Torrance. It was called Oscar Maples Ford at the time. And they had a stock car, and I'm sitting at home, and I knew one of the guys working on the car up there, and I was thinking about calling them and see if they'd let me drive their stock car. And about that time, the phone rang, and it happened to be the guy that I was going to call, and they wanted to know if I would come and drive their stock car. So that was a great introduction to my partner, Vel, who years we were together and later as a car owner. But anyway, I won a lot of races for them. I won the third race for them and started driving midgets and sprint cars and winning races in that, and finally went back in East in 1959. Ran a USAC race, which is the same people that run the Indianapolis 500, with a lot of the great superstars there, and set fast time and finished second in the main event that day. And so I knew then that I wanted to go, and you know, I was ready to go to the Indianapolis 500. And so I kind of set up in 1960 to come back and do the whole season before I went to Indy. And I did. I won the sprint car championship a couple of years in a row. I won the Midwest in 1960, won the Nationals in 1962. But I was running like 65 races a year. So I was running midgets, sprint cars, stock cars. And I also won the stock car championship in 1964. But in 1961, which was my rookie year at Indianapolis, I was rookie of the year and co-rookie actually with Marshman. And then in 62, I was set on the pole. I was the first to run 150 miles an hour there and was leading the race, long gone. Should have won that race, hands down, but I lost the brakes. And I made two pit stops without any brakes and wound up finishing, but I said no brains either. But and then I came back in 63, set on the pole, the fastest qualifier again, and won the race. And also finished second there in 1965. 67, I was leading a race there with 3.5 laps to go in the Turbin car for Andy Granatelli. And anyway, that helped me make a decision to quit running open cockpit cars. And so I kind of stuck to not quitting racing or retiring or anything like that. I just made a decision to quit running open cockpit cars and started doing, you know, stock cars and Trans Am cars and Baja races and things like that, yeah. And that's so I've had a great career in racing, and it's been very good to me.
Well, you're the legend.
Well, that's better in my profession. That's better than the second choice.
How'd you become a car owner?
Well, actually, you know, Vel, driving for Vel, you know, he actually wanted my partner. He wanted to support me in my Indy program. Obviously, he was a Ford dealer and had to support that as well. So he had to work at it and probably could not afford to do the IndyCar program and stock cars and everything that I wanted to do. And anyway, after years of doing Indy, he you know, got more and more interested in it. And so we became kind of a partner, and he wanted to get involved with Indy, and we sort of worked in it. We had a lesser team the first year or so, and I said, look, if we're going to do it, we got to get the right people, get the right team, get the right people working for us. And that time we hired George Bignotti and, of course, Jim Dellermarter, main individuals with our race team. And we started right off the bat, we started doing well, and we started winning races. And, of course, we probably should have won the championship maybe even 1 year before we did, but we wound up winning the championship 3 years in a row, won Indianapolis twice with Al Unser, and also we have the three trophies here that represent our three wins. Wow. My win in 1963, Al's in 70, and also Al's in 71. But you know, when you have a winning, start winning, building a winning team, pretty soon, you know, we had more sponsorship than we could put on our car. So we decided to run the second car. So we built the second car for Joe Leonard, and we did well with that. Joe, in fact, wound up first year, Al won the championship, and Joe won the championship the second year. And then we added Mario Andretti, because we had three major sponsors. And anyway, so they were calling us the super team. And with our team, we won 53 IndyCar races, won a championship 3 years in a row, won Indianapolis twice, the big races, won the 500 at Pocono, also the 500 at Ontario Speedway. So as a team owner, I'm probably more successful than I was ever been as a driver. But anyway, having a partner like Vel, and the people that we associated with, like Jimmy Dellermarter and George Bignotti, and some of the other teams that are in the people that work for us, we put together a great team. All right, this is Jim Dellermarter. Jim's been with us for about 40 years, forever seems like. But we've built a great relationship. He was also a great mechanic, and he was a great individual on our race team. And he was chief mechanic on our winning IndyCar in 1970-71. Also our championship 1 year, and quite a few of our winning races, as a matter of fact. And but anyway, Jim's been with us and been a great asset to our team. Held it together in a lot of cases, ran our Formula One team 1 year, and I couldn't have any more respect for anybody other than Jim. But it's just nice for you to be here. And
well, thank you very much. I appreciate the fine compliments. Well, thank you. Yes. Well, it's great to be here. It's certainly wonderful to have been able the opportunity to do what I've been able to do in my life. This is what I wanted to do when I was a young man, and even a young boy. I wanted to be a race car mechanic. I wanted originally to be a race car driver, but I found I didn't have enough talent. So I decided I would do something else, and it's worked out very well for me. And it's been a pleasure and a joy working for the Parnelli Jones and Vel Miletic families. I've done a lot of different things for them, and I couldn't have asked for a better place to work. As a matter of fact, I've always said this has never felt like a job to me. I've never felt like it's been work. Well, actually, Parnelli and I go back a lot longer than the 40 years that I've been working for him. Earlier on, in about 1967, was working for another team, and we decided that we were going to campaign a sports car in the Can-Am series. And it was co-sponsored by Firestone and Ford. And so that would mean the most likely driver who was available would have been Parnelli. And I was always hoping that someday I would get the opportunity to work on a car that he drove. And lo and behold, the opportunity came.
You didn't like me in 67, though.
This was 67.
You didn't like me then, remember?
Well, yeah, I didn't like him in 60. I lost love for him in 60, only 67, when he drove the turbine car. And I did not like him for that. However, I patched it up with him during the year when he drove the car. But I soon found out, though, that working for Parnelli, working on his race cars, wasn't so easy as it was with Al Unser, where Al Unser was a little conservative in his driving, and Parnelli was much more aggressive, and still is, by the way. It's every day is race day with Parnelli. Anyway, I was assigned to do the bodywork on the car, which was, unfortunately for me, the longest hours, because Parnelli had a knack for hitting every cone and every hay bale in the corner when he is cutting corners on this road course. And every time he'd go out, the car would have a cracked nose, smashed nose, pieces off it, and I'd have to stay late at night fixing the fiberglass nose. And that, however, it was very rewarding because we knew that we had a driver that was certainly capable of winning the race. And so it worked out wonderful for us, but that was my first time working on a car with Parnelli. But I've enjoyed every minute since then, actually.
Actually, one time I was driving when it ended, he pulled the gear shift right out of the car.
Yeah, Stardust Raceway in Las Vegas. You know, Parnelli had this reputation of being very hard on cars. And in fact, Bill Straub used to say Parnelli could break an anvil with a rubber hammer. So this one race, he was leading the race, and he came in about the third or fourth lap with a gear shift lever in his hand. So it tore it right out of the side of the car, which he was living up to his reputation. I like to tell a little story about Parnelli, and it relates to these trophies behind us. These are Indianapolis 500 winning trophies, and the year before that we had a very interesting development in the 1969 race when Al Unser was our driver. And the evening before the Indianapolis 500 qualifying, Parnelli and Al decided to go out for a motorcycle race. So why don't you tell him what happened the night, evening, Mr. John?
Actually, we had these little small Kawasaki motorcycles, and we were riding in the infield at Indianapolis, having a good time, and we're going through these little gullies that they use as drains for the water and stuff like that. Anyway, Al come out of one of them, fell over backwards, and the peg hit him in the ankle, and he got a compound fracture and couldn't run the race. And that was the first year that we'd put the Jim and Bignotti and Bell and I had put together the whole team and really had a great effort and had a great car. And here we blew it all right there. I almost got back in the car and started to bring back my career. I mean, I had quit in 1967. This was 69, I'd set out in 68. So it came close, and kind of glad now that I didn't, but I think if I had have probably still been there trying to run like some of the old-time drivers that stuck around too long.
Well, you'll notice the Vels Parnelli Jones Racing signs above our trophy case. When we moved our race shop and retired from racing and built some new buildings, we thought it'd be a good idea to take the letters that were on the building and put them on top of the trophy case. Those letters up there were done in 1971. So they've been in existence a long time, and hopefully be a long time to come.
We're upstairs where the real collection is. What's behind us here, Parnelli?
Well, actually, these are all of our entries at Indianapolis over the years, from 1967 through 1980 as a car owner. And even though I've driven in some of those races, We do have most of those cars that mean so much to us, our two winning cars, and of course our three championship winning cars. And when you accumulate and collect all this stuff, you wonder, what am I going to do with it? And finally, you have to find a home for it, because they're like little children, all these cars, and you got to keep them together and treat them well, keep them clean and air in the tires and that sort of thing. And so never, it's never ending.
Well, will you show us around?
Sure, love to. Well, you know, after winning Indianapolis as a car owner in 1970 and 71, this happened to be our 72 version. And that was the first year that we added three cars to our team, because before that we had obviously Al Unser and Joe Leonard, and then we added Mario. We built three of them, one for Al and Mario and Joe. And this particular car was built for Al, and we finished second at Indianapolis after winning 2 years in a row, and also the championship. But the story behind that is Roger Penske with Mark Donahue sat on a pole at Indianapolis, and they blew about six or seven engines during the practice and during the month of May. And the last minute, we were involved with a company that built our engines, and we sold them one of our engines. And they wound up winning the race. We finished second. Al Unser finished second in his car. Joe Leonard finished third in another car just like it. I think Mario was sixth or anyway. But after finishing second, after winning 2 years in a row and selling them the engine, I decided I better build a belt, and that had a boot on it and a button so I could kick my own butt. And basically that's the way I kind of felt after that year. But anyway, we were very successful with that car and at the end of the year, because Joe Leonard won the championship and won just like this one. Well, after 1972, with three cars with our Alan, Mario, and Joe, we built three new cars for them in 1973. And this car here being something special, because in 1973, we set a closed course world's record at 214 miles an hour at Texas Speedway while we were qualifying for the race. And we probably had close to 1,000 horsepower in the car at the time, because the Offenhauser engine, which was the same engine we had in the 72 car, we also had in 73, you could actually turn the boost up to make that kind of power. And the reason you could is because the Offenhauser engine, only being a four-cylinder engine, had no head gasket. And you actually bolted the half of the engine to the crankcase. And you could turn that power up a lot, and without breaking it and without blowing the head gasket. Well, this happens to be one of my favorite cars in this collection. It's not one that we built, but it was built in England by Colin Chapman of Lotus. And it was brought to Indianapolis in 1964. Jimmy Clark drove it. He sat on the pole, was the fastest qualifier, and was leading the race. And they ran Dunlop tires, I think, and the left rear tire came apart and tore the suspension up, and he didn't finish the race. Well, later that year, I was kind of contracted with Ford and Firestone. They wanted to run the car at Milwaukee, and they wanted me to drive it, and which I chose to do so. Anyway, it was the first rear engine car for me to drive. And I went up and set fast time and won the race up there. And then toward the end of the year, I drove the other Lotus, similar to identical to it, and won Trenton, New Jersey. At the end of that year, Ford then gave me this car, and that's the reason we still have it, obviously. And I came back and won Milwaukee again with it. And again, it was unique for me, because it was my first rear engine car to drive. And if you notice, or the suspension on the different side, it says longer A-arms on the right side than it does on the left. And the reason for that is you want to get as much weight to the left-hand side as you can, and that was their version of doing that. We don't do that anymore, but at that time, it seemed to work quite well. It had a Ford engine, and of course, when I drove it, it had Firestone tires on it, so it didn't tear the suspension up. And anyway, I went on, and Jimmy Clark won in a new Lotus, similar to this car. He won, and I finished second in 1965 with it at Indianapolis. So the car has quite a history. Well, you know, in 1967, I came within 3.5 laps of winning Indianapolis in a car that was just before this one here. This one here happened to be a better design maybe than the one that I driven. The engine was on the side, the one that I drove, and this one here having the engine in the rear. But both cars were four-wheel drive, and nobody really gave them a lot of credit for the handling qualities that they had. And the four-wheel drive really worked well, I know, in the one that I drove. And then, of course, Joe Leonard drove this car the next year, and Joe Leonard happened to be our driver, so we kind of loaned him to Andy Granatelli at the time because with STP, because he was our driver, and Andy kind of expected me to drive the car, and that was about the time that I decided that maybe I should back off and just drive cars with a roll cage over my head. So anyway, Joe drove the car, and he sat on the pole and was the fastest qualifier at 171 miles an hour, and led a good portion of the race and was leading the race with about, 12 laps or so, and the yellow flag came out. And when the yellow flag came out, the cars all bunched up, and when they dropped the green flag to go again, car wouldn't take off. Andy had made a deal with Standard Oil to run gasoline instead of the jet fuel, and the gasoline didn't have enough lubricant in it and froze up the fuel pump drive. And so the thing wouldn't take off. So after me coming almost in a year before of 3.5 laps of winning in the Turbine, Joe comes within about 12 laps of winning the following year. Anyway, the reason after that race was over, Firestone, who had financed a big portion of the race, wanted somebody to campaign the car the rest of the season. So we took on that because Joe was our driver, and we went, and every place we went, we set quick times, scared them and everything, never won a race. And the Turbine just seemed to be bit with some black mark on it or something like that. But it was a great car, great handling car. We had a lot of problems keeping the brakes on them because the thing about it, a Turbine engine, when you get it all wound up, when you back off, it's like the throttle stuck. So you really have to use the brakes to slow it down. And it made it a little more difficult to drive. It also had a little bit of throttle delay time. So you had to kind of outguess that a bit. But they were great cars, made a great impression at the Indianapolis 500, and we never won a race. The engine in this car is a helicopter engine. It's a Pratt PT6 helicopter engine, and makes about 550 horsepower and a tremendous amount of torque. I think it's probably somewhere around 850 foot-pounds of torque, or maybe even a little bit more. But it only weighs 265 pounds, which is relatively light compared to a combustion engine. And we actually had to put the weight on the car to get it up to its maximum 1,450 pounds. Well, this car here, the number 2 Johnny Lightning car, is probably my favorite car in here. We won Indianapolis with Al Unser in 1970, and we were the fastest qualifier at 170 miles an hour. And we actually led 190 or 191 laps of the 200, and really dominated the race. In fact, it didn't have one drop of oil coming out of it after the race was over, and I think he could have lined it up and run another 500 miles. In 1970, it was custom for us to, in the old garage doors, to actually put our qualifying times on every garage door that was for all the qualifiers. And that's what we did. And of course, they tore down the old garages at Indianapolis, and that's why we collected the original doors from our 1970 race. And we duplicated them here. But and then, of course, we come back in 1971 and won again with Al Unser and the Johnny Lightning Special. And of course, the car became number one because we won the championship. These two cars are very valuable to us, and the fact that they are Indianapolis winners, I can't say how much I appreciate being and owning them as well as my partner. Well, I have a photo that I'd really like you to see, and that's Louis Unser at Pikes Peak. And I want to tell you, he was really spectacular there. And the race went from 12,000 feet up to 14,000 feet, 14,110 feet, I think it was. And you could hardly breathe at the top. But when he went up the hill, he hung it out. After he got out of the tree line, he hung it out on the edge constantly and was really spectacular. Me, when I got out of the trees, I made sure I got to the top. I was a lot more careful than Louis Unser was. Well, in 1967, when I drove the turbine car, we also had an entry, and that was our one of our first years that Vel and I were partners in an IndyCar program. Of course, I'm driving the turbine car, and we had another driver driving our car. And we had a little lesser team. We didn't have a lot of big backing like we did later, but in doing so, when the race in 1967, it started raining after 18 laps, and I was, of course, leading the race, and when I came up to lap this car, which would happen to be part ownership of mine, and I pulled up beside him and motioned him to get going because it was raining and he couldn't see very well. I mean, none of us could because it was raining pretty hard. For some reason or other, he pulled in the pits. And when he did, he got a lap down, and because they hadn't black flagged the race yet. And Bell, my partner, he fired the driver and put another driver in it the next day when they restarted the race. But this is one of our first entries as a car owner with Vel. In 1972, when we first built cars for Mario and Al and Joe Leonard, this is basically what the cars look like. Had the dihedral wings here on the cars, and they had great merit, I thought. But when we got to Indianapolis, because we were a little late getting there, we weren't running quite as quick as we'd like to. So, and the drivers thought that because of these dihedral wings on the side, they couldn't see out the side, and they felt like there was another car there. And so they right away, they said, well, take them off. And of course we did, and went back to the conventional wing on the back and set up, and found out we run about the same speed as we were running before. And so we didn't get a chance to really sort this out. In fact, finally corrected the problem we had, which was in the front end, and we changed the roll center and corrected the car. And I think we qualified in the second, third row. And of course, Al finished second that year, and Mario, I think, finished sixth, but Joe Leonard finished third with the other car. So all three cars finished, but they weren't in this form. And so when we restored the car, we wanted to put one back with the dihedral wings on it. Well, after winning the national championship in 1970 with Al Unser, Joe Leonard won in 1971 in this car. And this car being an identical car to the 71 winning Indy car, of course, Joe won the 500 at Ontario Speedway 500 mile race. And also in winning a championship, won a couple of other races as well. Well, you wouldn't believe it, but this car here is designed and has the same specification as an Indianapolis car. The only difference is this car is designed for the dirt. Has the same wheelbase, same weight limit, and everything else. This particular car, over a period of 4 or 5 years, we only ran about 5 races a year, but it was attached to the championship in 1970. But in 1972, they took it out of the championship and made their own championship in the dirt. And so we only had about 4 or 5 races a year. And with that, this particular car won 13 out of 21 races with Al Unser. And we built a second one for Mario, and they run 1-2 in the championship. But of any car that we have, for the dollar we invested in this particular car, probably made us more money than any other. But it was a fabulous race car, and when we parked it, so to speak, we didn't want to restore it and paint it, make it look perfect, because we came off the dirt, and it has a lot of dirt markings and all that stuff on it, and I thought that played a great part in the car itself. Like in 1973, this particular car is a teammate to Mario Andretti's car that he set a close course world's record with. However, Al qualified well, but he did manage to win the 200-mile race, not the same time that we set the record, but we actually ran two races that year. This happened to be the earlier race, and we kind of cleaned up the chassis and had it a little more aerodynamic when Mario set the record. Well, after Joe won the championship in 1971, he came back and won again in 1972. He won actually four races that year and finished in the top five, 8 out of 9 races, including finishing third at Indianapolis. Anyway, he was very dominant that year and actually won the championship with a couple of races left that year, and won a 500-mile race at Pocono, and was real dominant.
Parnelli, how did you get into off-road racing?
Well, actually, joking aside, I couldn't stay on anymore. But really, I'd won the stock car championship for Bill Straub in the Mercury in 1964. And after that, Bill Straub was running two or three Ford Broncos and different off-road races, and he asked me to drive one. And I thought, well, no, that's not my cup of tea. So, but he knew how to get to me, and he said, well, you're probably not man enough to do it anyway. And that was like throwing a red flag. So I said, you get that sucker ready. And so anyway, the first race was the Mint 400 that I was going to do. And he put another guy with me, and so I said, if I'm running too hard or whatever, you know, tap me on the knee. And he about beat me to death, and obviously he was more correct than I, because I run the car right into the ground. I mean, knocked the front tires off it, cauliflowered the wheels around the backing plates, and it was a mess, and it finally just came to a stop and wouldn't run anymore. But before we got to the first pit stop. So anyway, that's kind of how I got started. But I noticed then that this was a recreational thing, and it seemed to be something that I really could enjoy my personal driving. And so anyway, later on, I think it was 1969, I ran the first Baja 1000. And again, I made it down the road about probably 250 miles down the road and tore the front end out of it. So I knew that if I was going to do any more, I needed to get something that could stay together as hard as I wanted to drive them. Anyway, so Ford had asked Straub to build a two-wheel drive Bronco. And he did, and took it back to Detroit. Detroit's decided they didn't want to do it. I said, well, gee, that's what I want for an off-road vehicle. And it was a two-wheel drive with an I-beam front suspension under it. And so anyway, I first raced with it. I won the Baja 500. And at that time, then I knew exactly what I wanted. And so that was the creation of the Big Ole. And of course, Big Ole got its name because Olympia Beer was the sponsor. And somehow the press picked up right away and named it Big Ole, and that picked up. And so we started just calling it Big Ole. But the fact that when we built it, it's all fiberglass body, has a tube frame, has an I-beam with trailing arms on it, and has a coil over, big coils on it, no leaf springs or anything like that. And custom built, you had to have a top on top of the car So I thought if we have to have a top, we might as well make a wing foil out of it. And we did, and the rear portion of that is adjustable, so you can, when you come over these rises, you can actually make it not come down on the nose and make it land on the rear wheels. And also has lights that pop out of the top, has a sort of a wind curtain, which I took off the idea off of my Lotus, which had basically the same thing. So I took all the ideas that I could, and we built this car, and and basically the first year we ran it was 1970, and we were leading the race by a ton, didn't know it. I mean, we got about 250 miles down the course, and I'm sitting in my pits, and about that time one of these dune buggies goes flying by, and so anyway, I took off chasing them. I'm looking for the dust, I'm trying to catch them and everything else. Well, I found out it would happen to be one of the guys that I had to beat had a pre-runner that looked like his race car, and they went down the road and pulled off into some trees and stuff like that, and I'm out there chasing nothing, and I'm driving over my head and got off the course and bent the rear end housing, and we managed to finish, but not very well. But I knew then that next year I just had to keep that thing together, and and not overkill it, and not let things like that bother me. Because anyway, when we come back the next year in 71 and won, actually going away, but and that's another story, because the record was like 16 hours and something. I think it was almost 17 hours, and after the officials would get on in an airplane after they started all the 3,300 cars, and they'd fly to the other end, and on the way down there they'd make up a pool what was going to be the quickest time. And my friend Nico Saad, that owned the San Nicolas Hotel, he asked me, he says, how long is it going to take you? And I says, 15 hours. So he got in the airplane and he put down 15 hours, and everybody else was putting 16, so on and so forth, and they thought he was nuts. Anyway, I did it in 14 hours and 59 minutes.
Pernelli, I understand you ran out of gas in this, and also there was a tequila bottle involved. Can you tell us about that?
Well, that's true. As a matter of fact, I was about 15 miles from the finish line, and ran out of gas, and was stomping up and down the thing. I could see the lights of La Paz, and there was a little, I looked up and there was a little light coming down the course, and it was a real dim light, and I thought it was like a bicycle light or something. But anyway, when it got there, it was a couple of Mexican guys, and the belt had came off their engine, and it wasn't charging, so that's why the light was so dim. But the fortunate thing is they had a full tank of gas, and so I ran over there, and I pulled out a $20 bill, and they had a bottle of tequila, and which is here, and I grabbed it, poured the bottle of tequila out, poured it out, and handed the guy 20 bucks, and ripped off one of his windshield wiper hoses and siphoned one bottle at a time, and until I got it filled, and got it up to probably enough gas to make it to 15 miles that we were there. But what happened on the last pit stop is the Mexican guy that was pitting this side, because he has two fillers, one on each side, and when he went to dump, instead of dumping it in the gas, he opened this here, which is the thermos bottle, and poured the gasoline in the thermos. Of course, obviously it overflowed real quick, and at that point we went stomping out without enough fuel, I guess, and obviously we didn't, because that created us running out that close to the finish line. Well, I'd like to show you what the car looked like after the 1973 500. I took off, and believe it or not, I got a few miles down the road. I laid it on its side, and there happened to be a motorcycle guy there, and he was, and it kind of laid on a piece of cactus, and so between the three of us, we were able to plop it back over on its wheels and continue on down the course. We went about probably another 15, 20 miles down the course, and I went around an off-cambered turn and laid it on its side again. And there happened to be a lot of, because there was a big aurora there, a big deep gully. And when I went around the corner, just kind of laid over real easy. And the Mexican spectators that was there came over, grabbed it, and put it back on its wheels like that. And that didn't hurt it too bad. However, I think it got a little air in the brake lines, and I was having to pump the brakes for the rest of the race. Well, I came to about 75 miles from the finish line, and they said, man, you got a tremendous lead, so just take it easy going in. So I did. I started taking it easy, and I quit pumping the brakes. And I came to a drop-off, which I knew was there. And when I hit the brakes and went to the pedal, went to the floor, I pumped it, and I couldn't get it to enough pedal to stop it at the time. And I went off there sideways, and this time I rolled it really in a ball. And basically, that's what it looked like after the race. And so when it was on its side, we weren't able, Bill and I weren't able to pop it back over, but we were close enough to the course. And when the first dune buggy came by, I got on the road and stopped him. And we always carried a 25-foot nylon line, and Bill Stroppen ran over and hooked it onto the back of the deal and plopped the thing back over. And of course we went on and were able to finish the race and win. And that's when my friend said, if that's the winner, I'd hate to see what the losers look like. It tore it up pretty good, but it had a broken hunk out of the wheel, had only one headlight left, but it was a miracle that we were able to finish and win. This is our Formula One car that that Mario ran in a little bit in 74, 75, and 76. But what happened is Mario wanted to go do Formula One, and he approached Firestone with, of course, involved with us because he was our driver. And we put this program to build these cars here in America and do Formula One with Mario. And in doing so, just about the time we finished the program or building the cars, Firestone decided to that they didn't want to be in racing and they wanted to get out. So it changed the whole attitude for us. And but anyway, we went on and went to bought a place over in England. Jim ran the program, and anyway, we were going to run the thing in the hopes of us getting a sponsorship. Well, we did. We ran the whole 75 season, and with Mario, he did well at some of the races. And anyway, we scored some points, but we didn't get a sponsor at the end of the year, so we kind of had to pull the plug after a couple of races in 1976. But anyway, Jim ran the program, and maybe he can give you a little more details of how the season went.
Yes, I'd be glad to do that, Parnelli. As he said, we did start out racing these cars in late 74. We finished in the points in the very first race at Mossport, Ontario. And then we set second quick time at Watkins Glen at the very next race. However, we had some unfortunate at the start of the race. We had vapor lock and the car wouldn't start. We had to push it back to the pits, and in Formula One you can't do that, so they disqualified us. But we ran most of the 1975 races with Mario, and who was doing a full schedule, by the way. He was not only doing Formula One, he was also doing IndyCar racing and Formula 5000 road racing for us. So he was a very busy driver that year. And in 1976, we raced only two races, one in South America at Johannesburg, and the final race that this car ran, which I can explain a little further when we move to the next car, was in Long Beach, California. That was our very last race. And as Parnelli mentioned also, that we did have a facility in England. We were about 100 miles northeast of London, and it was very near the Lotus factory, where all the famous Lotuses were built. And part of our staff were ex-Lotus employees. The car itself is a very lightweight car. The weight restrictions on Formula One are a lot less than IndyCars. where the car, Indy cars are 1,450 pounds in those days. This car only had to weigh about 1,230 pounds, very light. And also, as Parnelli alluded to, we used this basic model to build a brand new Indy car patterned after this car several years later. But this car was really an evolutionary car of a Lotus because it was designed by a former Lotus engineer, Maurice Philippe. It had a 3-liter dual overhead cam Ford Cosworth normally aspirated engine, front inboard brakes, which is very novel. We were the only second car to do that sort of thing. But the car was fairly successful in the short time it ran, and we were very proud of this car. As you can see by the side, we flew the American flag along with Roger Penske's team, and I myself enjoyed the Formula One circuit because this little guy from Canada was able to see the world and enjoy myself. I did miss my home, however, but I did enjoy very much traveling for the Vels Parnelli Jones team in Formula One. As I said earlier, I'd like to point out the difference between the two cars, other than the obvious, which is the colors. This car, which is the car that ran Long Beach for the very last time, has a high air box. And this allows air to be rammed into the engine at a high rate of speed, and it gives the engine more horsepower because it increases the RPM of the engine. And basically, that's the main difference between these two cars.
I understand there's an interesting story behind this picture.
Well, actually, it happened a long time ago, but...
But if we twist your arm, will you tell us the story?
Okay, all right. It was at Riverside in the Motor Trend 500. Dan Gurney had just set a new track record, and they were about ready to have a big hope to do with that. And I went out and broke his track record by 2 seconds. Well, when I did that, NASCAR called me to the trailer, wanted to know if I had enough tires to supply the whole field. And I said, no, I didn't. And they made me go back and run on year-old tires. They didn't take my track record away, but they made me start dead last. Anyway, so when I did, I rolled down the window when I took the lead and gave them the one more lap sign. Well, as you can see, we ran all kinds of races. Matter of fact, Firestone, we were Firestone distributor for the 11 Western states with their racing tires. And they wanted a house car, so to speak, one that they could use for testing tires. We also had a double-A dragster as well. But anyway, we won quite a few races, won the championship with this car with Danny Angais. And we, at that time, were running all different kinds of cars, from the midgets to the sprint cars to the champ cars, the Trans Am cars, Indy cars, stock cars. We seemed to have our hand in a little bit of every kind of racing there was. And the drag cars were little bit out in left field for us, but we got in and got the right people, got the right driver, and won some races. Well, first of all, this is considered a funny car, and it is funny in a lot of ways. I mean, obviously, it has an all fiberglass body, and it sets down over a dragster type chassis, and even has a parachute on the back of it, because this car ran over 200 miles an hour. And obviously in a quarter, and you have to be able to slow them down at the end, and sometimes the brakes are not enough, so you obviously have to have a parachute to slow them down, same as with the dragster as well.
Okay, Parnelli, I understand this is the car that puts you on the map. Can you tell us about that?
Well, it certainly is. This is not the actual car. This is a replica of an identical replica, as a matter of fact, of my original car, which is in the museum at Indianapolis. But we always thought that we ought to have one here. And my partner, Val, before he died, he contracted this thing out to have one built just identically to the one that in the Speedway. And however, this is when... you know, the Roadster, I mean, it fits like a glove. You know, I can get great feelings when I sit in here and think about it. But this is when the tires were skinny and the drivers were fat. But anyway, it was a great thrill with it to be associated with this car, because in the 4 or 5 years that we ran the car, you know, it was probably one of the most popular Roadsters of all time, because Lloyd Ruby drove it the first year. I think he finished seventh, and then I was rookie of the year, led the race for 27 laps. It in 1961, and then in 1962, we were the fastest qualifier at 150 miles an hour at Indy. Come back again the following year in 63 and won the race, set on the pole again. And then in 64, while leading the race, I came into pits and the car caught on fire in the pits, and that ended this car's career, but the actual car. But because of that, it became very popular. I mean, most of the roadsters were built around it. We changed it from year to year. We updated it. It wasn't the same car every year that we brought back. We made a lot of major changes, some good, some bad. I think the last car that caught on fire in the pits, I think we made a big mistake. We made a tail tank all made out of aluminum, and we used to carry 75 gallons of fuel, and I think the tank in aluminum was probably not as strong as the past steel tank that we had. And all in all, the car was great, and handled great, and fit me well at Indianapolis, and we had great success.
Parnelli, you're holding a milk bottle, just like you are in the picture behind you on Victory Lane. Can you tell us why you're holding the milk bottle, and tell us a little bit about what it felt to win then?
Well, I can't tell you how much it means to me for sitting here duplicating my winning at Indianapolis in Victory Lane. But the Milk Bottle Association out of Indianapolis started way back in the 30s, and they decided it was a great promotion for their milk. And I think Louis Myers won the first year, and thank God I was fortunate to do that. And it just was a tremendous thrill to get in there and take a big swift of milk in Victory Lane.
Well, thank you, Parnelli, for sharing your car collection and your stories. They're really something. Is there something else you'd like to add?
Well, you know, I have to give a lot of credit to my partner, you know, Val. We lost him about 10 years ago, and he's the one that's really responsible for us collecting and saving all these cars. Of course, Jim, that works for us, you know, obviously did all the preparation and taking care of him and all that. And it's just nice to... for us to enjoy them, and I hope that you enjoyed them as well as we enjoy them.
Oh, absolutely. Thank you for having us.
Thank you.
This has been Peninsula Seniors Out and About. I'm Betty Wheaton.
And Parnelli Jones.
See you next time.